Sister Magdalene from the Stavropedic Monastery of St. John the Baptist, Tollisant Knight in Essex. Sister.
I first would like to say that it's cumbersome to keep saying monk or nun, he or she. And if I say the word monk, it includes the nuns, except in one case, which will become obvious. The lives are identical. Monasticism is integral to the life of the Orthodox Church, even though relatively few of its members become monks or nuns. It may be extra parochial, but it's certainly not extra ecclesial. Through the bishop and the Eucharist, every monastery belongs to a diocese. Monasticism is not an obligation for all. In Matthew's Gospel, we read that after some injunctions of Christ about marriage, his disciples say to him, "If the case of the man be so with his wife, it is not good to marry." But he said unto them, "All men cannot receive this saying, except those to whom it is given." And then he speaks about the eunuchs and speaks about those who have, obviously spiritually, made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake, which, according to the patristic interpretation, means those who have chosen a life of consecrated celibacy. "He that is able to receive this saying, let him receive it." An important parenthesis: the idea that it is not good to marry is the reaction of the apostles to the Lord's teaching about marriage. It is not the general tradition of the church that it is not good to marry. In 1 Timothy 4:3, St. Paul says very harsh words about people who teach wrong ideas, calling them liars and diabolic teaching and so forth. And among the errors, he lists those who forbid marriage. There was a council in, not quite sure when, more or less 350 in Gangra. And in its canons are the following clauses. "If anyone should remain a virgin or observe continence, as if abominating marriage, he had become a hermit, and not for the goodness and holiness of virginity, let him be anathema." And there's a second one similar. And another one in another council. Incidentally, the fact that they needed canons already about this in 350 shows that monasticism was very well established. Marriage is a sacrament, and so is monastic tonsure a sacrament. As Father said this morning, the whole life of the church is one sacrament. We do not limit the number. But in some patristic lists, or even of seven, because after the Protestants and the Catholics disagreed about certain sacraments, the Orthodox began to be asked, well, do you have three or two like the Protestants or seven like the Catholics? And yes, we've got all the seven. And they started to speak in those terms. And in more than one occasion in the Fathers, you find lists of sacraments, including monasticism. And sacrament in an Orthodox, and not a Western sense, sacrament in an Orthodox sense, that God performs the action with the participant's willing consent, and the material signs and symbols involved do not simply portray what is happening invisibly. They put it into effect through themselves being penetrated by grace. In the service of tonsure, you see this hear these words: "O new vocation, O gift of the sacrament, today, brother, thou dost receive a second baptism." It's true that baptism is renewed by the tonsure, and it, to a certain extent, imitates a baptism, a white robe, a tonsure, and so forth. Of course, the term second baptism means the renewal of the baptism rather than, it doesn't contradict our creed about one unrepeatable and ineffaceable baptism. Each of the garments and their color of the monk or nun are bestowed with prayer, and their sacramental significance is highlighted in the instructions to each garment. If we had more time, we could go into each one. The schema itself, that's to say the embroidered cloth that is worn at the tonsure, is embroidered with the cross and with acronymic messages. Again, I have a list of them, but we don't have time. Another example of a physical aspect of this sacrament is the scissors and the tonsure itself. As in baptism, it means new life dedicated to God. And after that, which continues a tradition dating back to the Old Testament, once dedicated to God, there is no more shaving nor cutting hair off the women. Monasticism is undertaken voluntarily. It's interesting to compare it with priestly ordination, where the candidate is, I don't want to say the wrong word, he cannot make one step. He is like pulled. And he's not demanding it as a right, but as an accepted service demanded by the church, not an ambition or something like that. Well, monasticism is not an ambition either, but it's definitely something freely chosen and not imposed. The voice of God calling the monk or the nun is definitely felt as an inner compulsion, but not as a reluctant obligation, a kind of the renunciation is of the natural course of human life is not really renunciation. It's actually too negative a word. And certainly it is not sacrifice, at least not by the time the person is accepted into the novitiate. It may be that something had to be renounced with difficulty along the way. Throughout history, people have entered upon this life filled with such longing for God that any other path has no attraction. Even the blessed path of matrimony or service to their fellow men. Monastic life includes the renunciation of civic responsibilities. Even any service the monk or nun later undertakes in the church is undertaken by obedience and definitely forms no part of the original monastic vocation. The one who seeks monasticism is usually motivated by hunger for prayer and repentance for the sake of his own salvation. Some rarer beginners are already afire with a selfless love for God. You cannot make a recruitment drive for monasteries. As an illustration, there is the account of a Russian starets who was asked by a man seeking his path whether the elder would recommend monasticism, and the elder replied, no. Astonished, the questioner asked him, why not? And the answer, because if monasticism were for you, you would not be asking. You would have been banging on the gate for 3 days, begging to be let in. The service of monastic profession reflects this with questions to the candidate, which outnumber the vows enormously. Why hast thou come here? I desire the life of asceticism. Dost thou desire the habit and to be ranked in the company of those who are living monastic life? Yes, Reverend Father, I desire it with all my heart. Have you come of your own willing mind to the Lord? Yes. Not by any necessity or constraint? No. And then there's an exhortation followed by these words: "See that thou art desiring of set purpose the betrothal of the angelic habit." And by the way, this word betrothal, just another parenthesis, I said that monastic tonsure imitates baptism. It doesn't have, it has nothing to imitate a wedding. And the nuns are not brides of Christ. And in our time, Father Sofroni found that idea a little bit unhealthy somehow. There is no difference between the service for monks and nuns, except some reference to holy nuns or holy monks. Monastic life is not on the level of gender. Everything is on the level of personhood, as in heaven, where there is no marriage nor giving in marriage. And in that sense, it's called angelic life. Of course, in the great ascetics of old, they really were living more than halfway to heaven, with their physical asceticism so strong that they were freed from bodily needs much more than the modern monastics are usually able, for various reasons which, well, in the questions we could go into it if necessary. And finally, three times the scissors are taken by the candidate from the gospel and given to the hands of the, usually an igumen, or anyway, the priest who is the hieromonk who is doing the service. And he puts it back: take the scissors and give them to me. And three times the scissors are given. It's the demand of the heart of the candidate. Abandoning society may seem to contradict the commandment of love for one's neighbor. In America, I had to speak in a Protestant faculty on the question, is monasticism Christian? Yes. Yes. In the Christian understanding, however, every change wrought by the grace of God, even in the secret of the heart, benefits the whole universe. Furthermore, as soon as someone enters the monastery, they find out that the monastery itself is a school where one learns to practice the commandment of love for one's neighbor. The monastic community, unlike a family or a group of like-minded friends, is not formed because of relationships based on psychological ties. In the community, the monk learns to accept all the varying characters as his own life, which is one of the central meanings of love your neighbor as yourself. This prepares the heart to accept a multitude of people and leads to universal, all-embracing, godlike, eternal love. Other loves are more restricted. They are blessed, but they are more limited for good reason. Marriage limited to one person. Friendship to a smaller circle, a small circle of people. Kinship also to a circle of people. And even those who live in seclusion usually do so after many years in community. And any vocation to hermit life is severely tested. All the vows that are made favor love. Here are the questions asked of the postulant for the small schema, the second stage of sacramental tonsures, the first one with vows. Will you remain in the monastery and in abstinence even to your last breath? That's the first question. The commitment must be mutual. Everything is given and everything is received. The community and the monk mutually commit. Love develops if you live together for life. joining a monastery means joining a certain group of people with whom you promise to remain. You don't join an order. You're not transferable. You may be sent elsewhere, but again, that's a personal matter. There aren't types of spirituality or orders in the Orthodox Church. A child and a monk use the same services, the same fasts, and above all, the same spiritual principles. The measure may vary, of course, but even between monks and nuns, the measure may vary. Second question. Wilt thou preserve thyself in purity and chastity and in piety? All the other members of the community are seen as brothers or sisters in Christ. In his text, The Feast of the Virgins, St. Methodius of Olympus speaks of virginity as an extraordinarily great work, a sacrament, mysterium. I do not like the idea of sublimation. The sexual dimension of human relations is simply avoided in monasteries, in thought, word, and deed, except if there's some kind of objective conversation about it. And there is no loss of humanity in this, as our Lord, the perfect man, shows. In advanced monks and nuns, even gender differences on the psychological level disappear, and only the bodily ones remain. There are other things to say, but perhaps they will come in questions. Third question. Will you continue obedient even unto death to thy superior and all the brethren in Christ? And that I would like to say more about shortly. And the fourth question, will you endure every affliction and poverty of monastic life for the sake of the heavenly kingdom? Sometimes called the vow of poverty, but it's really a vow of non-ownership and non-acquisition. Everything is everyone's. Nothing is claimed in a proprietary way. If you need something, you ask for it, and you may receive it. Usually, yes, if you need it. And the fact that everything is shared and that need is the criterion limits drastically the effect of the monastery on the environment, and it also limits their need to earn money. In other words, they can have more time for prayer. And this sharing applies to money, to objects, books you may bring to the monastery, talents, gifts. In the early church, these principles were kept by the whole church, but unfortunately it didn't last, and also for practical reasons it was difficult to continue. It is a blessing to live in a monastery. Monastic life is dedicated in every detail towards spiritual aims. The buildings, the program, the clothing, and above all, the mind and heart of the monk can focus on the kingdom of God. However, the principal difference between monasticism and other Christian life styles and the principal privilege of monasticism lies in the sacrament of obedience. Obedience is based on free commitment and trust to a spiritual guide and to the head of the community. And often these roles are combined, but not necessarily. With confidence, love, and joy, the novice readily submits his own will and jurisdiction over himself. In this way, he is freed from earthly concerns, and this enables him to acquire pure prayer. Father Sofroni says, obedience is a mystery which is revealed only by the Holy Spirit. Obedience is both sacrament and life in the church. The monk or nun vows obedience to the superior and to all the brotherhood or sisterhood. Like the other vows, this furthers love and unity. Unity of will is quickly achieved if the desire of each one is to do the will of the others. Quarrels, as well as long debates about what to do, are also avoided. I quote again Father Sofroni, who had not only experience of monastic life, but experience of being Father Confessor to hundreds of monks, especially on Athos. This sacrament, obedience, for the novice, consists in learning to do the novice, meaning the one who's obeying, consists in learning to do the will of God in order to enter into the sphere of the divine will and thereby participate in the divine life. For the starets, the one who is obeyed, the sacrament means, by his own prayer and life of spiritual endeavor, bringing the novice to knowledge of that life and the development in him of true freedom, without which salvation is impossible. The purpose of obedience is the acquisition of the Holy Spirit. In all forms of Christian life, there is obedience and cutting of the will in that sense. But in the monastery, the obedience is somehow guaranteed to teach you the will of God, which it can be useful to obey your boss at work, but it's not guaranteed that he or she is giving you the will of God. The unearthly focus of the monks is a result of grace, second to the grace of the martyrs who with joy suffer death for the Lord. It is not motivated by hatred of creation or of the body or of the human will. It is freedom to keep all these in the second place on every level. If the otherworldliness of monasticism engenders pride, this is quickly squashed by the spiritual guides. And you can see this in the stories of the Desert Fathers. The monks come to a group of monks who are discussing about building or vegetable growing or selling their work, and the new visiting monks say, "Oh, what worldly monks these are! We are thinking about heaven," and the monks arrange a meal and don't invite the visitors and say to them, "Well, we thought you were so in the other world." There is no naivety about this otherworldliness. The elders take, especially in the case of the beginners, the elders take the care for the financial and material and even spiritual cares that the novice is freed from. And older monks have learned to combine work with prayer. Furthermore, none of the tasks are self-chosen, so that the element of grace-filled service in all the work is as high as humanly possible. The element of self-will and passion is minimized. But I repeat, this is not some kind of naivety. Father Sofroni used to tell us a story about a monk who had told him that when he was young, he was waiting eagerly for his starets to come back from the meeting of the council of the elders of the monastery. And he asked his elder, "What are the elders saying? Are they happy with the spiritual life of the monastery? Elder, tell me, are they? And the elder said to him, "I'm very sorry to disappoint you. We discussed the new drains." Yes. So Father Florovsky is right when he says what is important is a consistent use of eschatological measures in the estimation of all things. First comes love. There is a second way to consider the monastery as a school of the commandment to love our neighbor. The monk may begin with concentration on himself, but the deeper the repentance, the deeper the compassion for his fellow men, who are likewise struggling for salvation. Christian prayer thus extends to embrace the whole of mankind. The monk or nun can devote much time and effort to prayer for others. This is the way they help the church and the world. Nowadays, there are many pastoral needs, and monasteries all over the world, even on somewhere isolated like Athos, have opened their doors to pilgrims and give time to guide and teach them. Monastic lifestyle has also served to remind all the faithful of our heavenly calling. Allow me another parenthesis. Some church histories are so written without knowledge of their monastic life, and they say that monasticism flourished when the Byzantine Empire was founded because the monks thought that the church would become too worldly if it was allowed to live in civilization, and so the monks set themselves up as a kind of witness to the otherworldliness of the church. Well, I'm sorry, they didn't. They went to the desert to be with St. Anthony or to pray. And the effect on the others, if they are humble, is to is true. They could remind the others, but they didn't. It's not their vocation. Even the prayer for the world is not usually part of the vocation. It comes as a fruit. Intercession is the fundamental service of the monastery. In spite of any pastoral help that the monks and nuns of today give and have given in the past, Saint Silouan says the following, which I hope will not shock you too much. If a monk be lukewarm and indifferent and has not arrived at a state wherein his soul continually contemplates the Lord, then let him wait upon pilgrim travelers and assist with his labors those who live in the world. This too is pleasing to God, but rest assured that it is not the monastic life by a long way. And true monasticism is not the kind of cop-out from service. Saint Silouan said that to pray the service of the monks, to pray for the others, is to shed blood. In gratitude for this prayer, all the faithful venerate monasticism, whatever their own personal path. I think that a sign of having a true Orthodox faith is to be what they say in Greek, philomonachos, to respect monasticism and celibacy, and not to consider it some kind of aberration, even if it's not your calling. I don't think there's any need to have some kind of complex about your calling. The thing is to follow your calling. St. John Chrysostom says in a sermon commenting on the prayer of Christ, that they may be one as we are one. But what of the monk, you will say? What of those who dwell in the mountains? Though they turn away from the common life, they have many companions in the spirit. They are close bound to one another in love, and they have withdrawn from the world the better to fulfill this purpose. Because of this, they retire from the world, that they may love more perfectly. How can a man have friends if he is alone, you will say? It is not the place that makes friends. The monks have friends who praise them, and who would not praise them if they did not love them. They pray for all men, and this is the greatest proof of their love. Incidentally, another parenthesis, this prayer of Christ, that they may be one as we are one, is of course the theology of the church's unity, but in the monastery, for example, of Saint Sergius, deliberately named his monastery after the Holy Trinity because he wanted the monastery, not only the family is a micro church, but the monastery. And Father Sofroni, in his testament to us, most of it is about these words of Christ. Sin is not automatically excluded by any sacrament. It is possible to sin after baptism, after the grace of holy matrimony. It is also possible to sin after the renewal of baptism in monastic tonsure. In the exhortations at his profession, the monk is enjoined to have endurance, and some of this endurance is learned by practicing patience with the sins of others who live in his own community. People who pray become very sensitive to traces of negativity in others, although they avoid any psychological or pathological self-pity, but they do feel the things. Have a footnote with some stories, but we'll leave the stories for now. This sensitivity makes even a thought against a prayerful person painful to them. But because the path is one of self-abasement and repentance, the monk will be taught to be concerned so much about his own sins that he easily forgives others. He is taught to think, "I am the greatest sinner surrounded by saints." And because of his faith in the love of God, he can bear this thought without any despair. Monks, and this is where I would make a difference, to a lesser extent nuns, monks live with spiritual guides. Some nuns do not have easy access to spiritual fathers. But any case, monks and to a lesser extent nuns live with spiritual guides and have more access to confession than most lay people. But still, church history has a number of sad stories about serious failures of monks and nuns to keep their vows at all times. And you can read stories of unkind behavior in the life of a contemporary saint monk, Siloam. The church history is also replete with accounts of lay people sent by God to shame monks to keep them humble, like the shoemaker sent to humble Saint Anthony, and many other cases. The priest says to the candidate before the vows, "Our Savior himself and his all-praiseworthy mother and the holy angels and all his saints is here present, listening to your words that proceed from your mouth, so that when he comes to judge the living and the dead, he may render to you not according to what you are about to agree and confess, but according as you shall have kept what..." Just a second. I lost the last page. It's here somewhere, I hope. Just one second. Sorry about that. "Not according to what you say, but according to the practice of what you are going to confess." St. John's Ladder has many mentions of sins in monasteries, and even worse, of sins picked up in monasteries. This previous point was necessary for a comprehensive picture of life in the monastery. However, this painful aspect does not diminish the gratitude of the monk for his lifestyle and for all who help him along it. Many of his problems are solved when he asks himself, "Why did you come here?" Saint Ignatius Brancianinov said that the monasteries are the barometer of the state of the church. I hope I have shown you why.